Hi, I'm Max Kaiser. This is the Max and Stacy Report coming to you from El Salvador, land of the free, home of the Bitcoin. Global markets are crashing, as we've been telling you they would now for many years and for all the reasons we said that they would. Stacy.
Max, the great repricing is happening, and that is why we have the return of Max and Stacy with the Max and Stacy Report. First, I'll start with this headline because there are so many charts out there describing, showing, demonstrating what is going on with this topsy-turvy world we find ourselves in once again. The last time we were in similar circumstances was, of course, 2008, 2009. The unnatural speed of the moves in bond and FX markets, you know, foreign exchange markets, into decade-plus highs is staggering. A wholesale repricing of all things at breakneck speed. The soft landing is pretty much off the table. Here you see the 2-year, the 10-year US Treasuries, and then you see the Japanese yen and the US dollar along the bottom there in the charts. And what you see are quite extraordinary moves looking back decades.
Right, so this is the global financial crisis of 2008, part two. As you recall, back then we were saying, hey, you know what, there needs to be a genuine reform in these financial markets. They need to get rid of all the highly toxic speculative derivatives, concatenation of debt, Ponzi scheme-onomics. But instead, they simply gave central banks and banks on Wall Street a bigger credit card to do the exact same thing, but 20, 30 times bigger. And I said at the time, within 10, 12 years, we'd have another exact same event, except it would be bigger. Okay, that's exactly what's happened. Exactly predictable. Now we have the global financial crisis part two. All the markets are crashing. We have insolvency. Remember in 2008, they said it's not an insolvency problem, it's a liquidity problem. No. The problem was insolvency, and they should have put a lot of bankers in jail like they did during the Pecora Commission back in the 30s. But of course, there's no regulators. There's nobody calling stop on the fraud. So now it's just gotten 20, 30 times bigger. And this is only going to cause so much hardship and problems all around the world, in particular in America, as the US dollar reserve goes bye-bye.
Of course, you know, the bond markets are down like 25% in the first half of the year, which is, of course, horrible, one of the worst in decades. But I'm going to look at the 10-year Treasury because, of course, that is basically upon which the entire global financial system is based, on this number alone. So just to see how extraordinary the situation is at the moment. And what we see is an update on the U.S. 10-year Treasury, y-axis and log scale, by the way, the 40-year trend is becoming quite volatile. So as you see here, Max, this is the 40-year trend. This is, by the way, when Max Kaiser first started working on Wall Street, way up when the 10-year was trading at a much higher rate, closer to 20%. And here you have, the ever-declining interest rates, which enabled the expansion of this debt, the rolling over of the debt at ever lower rates for the past 40 years. Well, as you can see, something has happened. Something is broke. The risk that is now in the system is being repriced very rapidly across all markets, including crypto and Bitcoin.
Right. These markets today are like Catholicism without hell. Right? You need penalties and you need a deterrent to commit fraud. If over the past 20, 30, 40 years, every time a major bank like Jamie Dimon, JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, and all the banks around the world committed massive fraud, they got bailed out. And the way that they paid for those bailouts was by lowering rates artificially and by extending maturity of the bonds. That's called a Ponzi scheme. Now, finally, in 2022, the world has called time and said, you know what, this Ponzi scheme-onomics has got to go. And the pain and suffering as a result of allowing this thing to grow for decades, really going back to Alan Greenspan in the 1980s, is going to be absolutely horrific.
I'm going to look at just a tweet during this past week or two and just highlighting the chaos that nothing makes sense. But nothing has made sense for quite a long time, especially since August 1971. We've been in an increasingly nonsensical sort of fiat fraud world. And the fact that you could fabricate a lot of growth and wealth that actually was never there in the first place and yet so many people believed that everything was real. The disintegration of that, I think, is what we're starting to see. Here is a tweet from the Kobieski letter. Current situation, S&P 500 in free fall like it's 2001. Treasury yield soaring like the S&P is at 6,000 when it was under 4,000. Gold down like inflation is gone. Gas prices above $5 like inflation is 15%. U.S. dollar at a decade high like we're in deflation. Literally nothing is adding up. Again, you know, this is like the event horizon. Once you go over the event horizon into the black hole of debt and, the, you know, the deglobalization and demonetization of the U.S. Treasury reserves is not a pretty sight. It's a chaotic sight, and everything will be in a whirlwind of repricing and then mispricing during the repricing, I would say in the case of, say, Bitcoin or gold. But those will, at the end, after we exit the worst of the chaos, you might see different prices after that.
Right, okay, so what economists say is something called moral hazard, that it's okay to allow for a little fraud in the system because we want markets to be liquid. That's what Alan Greenspan explained back in the 1980s. And this is about the idea that if you need market action and market prices and market orders at the market, if there's no buyers for a seller and there's no seller for a buyer, specialists are allowed to cook the books a little bit, a wiggle room, to keep markets open. But what's happened is that little wiggle room with the use of derivatives over the past 30 years has become the defining characteristic of these markets. They're completely fraudulent. So you lose, as you point out, you lose the idea of a price signal. All of these markets, when you add it together, the bond market, the stock market, the currency market, they're all flashing contradictory signals because they're all existing in what we call sometimes the Bermuda Triangle of markets, where none of the gauges on of your, if you're an economist or you're running a pension fund or you're running a retirement account, all of your gauges telling you where you are in the economy and these markets is just dials spinning wildly in opposite directions because the central banks have allowed the fraudsters to take over, essentially, and now we're having a catastrophic collapse, as we predicted, and nobody knows what to do, or nobody is willing to take the steps required to rectify the situation in a meaningful way.
Right. Well, part of it is, as you say, the central banks are have been trying to exert control since 1971, especially intervening in what they think the price should be, or what they think the price of risk should be, or the price of money. The, you know, the Politburo of the FOMC meets in Washington, D.C. and decides what the price of money, the main money that, you know, upon which quadrillions in derivatives and debt and economic activity are built upon. So that is part of the problem that we're seeing here. And what many are thinking that the U.S. Federal Reserve might engage in, because, of course, we entered quantitative easing back in 2008, a few decades after Japan. Japan was the one that led us into this, remember. And the yen is, again, really important to the global financial system in terms of that carry trade and the funding currency for a lot of the, you know, the speculative activity that goes on globally. So here's an interesting thing that happened as well in the past week. Japan's MMT experiment just failed today. Japan has been buying unlimited amounts of government bonds to keep yields below 0.25%, 25 basis points, on their 10-year government bond. Yields smashed through the 25 basis points and have soared to 45 basis points in the past 2 hours alone. What comes next? This YCC yield curve control program has caused the Japanese yen to lose 25% of its value against the US dollar in the last 3 months alone. And so you could see from that chart, it goes back to 1986, right after the Plaza Accords of 1985. Remember when Reagan and the G5 met to basically they decided that the US dollar was too strong. Again, they might decide that right today because the US dollar is soaring, and that's part of the reason why the global financial system is falling apart. But we could see another sort of Plaza Accord where they try to say, let's all work together and manipulate the currency. In that case, you saw the yen soar. Well, now it's crashing.
Right, absolutely. The yen has always been the linchpin to the whole global Ponzi schemonomics because it was always the funding currency. It was always the cheapest place to borrow money. You could borrow money for a quarter of a point or less, and you could go invest it through the carry trade into a higher yielding currency and then leverage that trade almost infinitely through infinite rehypothecation and just print money all day long. And because Japan at one point had a huge savings in their pension accounts, they were able to make this trade possible. But they burnt through their savings, and now suddenly the game is over. So I would say the most significant news of the week would be what's happening in Japan. When you blow away the smoke and you blow away all the other problems with the bond market and the stock market and the crypto market, not the Bitcoin market, but the crypto DeFi, you know, garbage market, the single point of data that is the most significant is what's happening with the Japanese yen.
Yes, the government buying the debt there. And of course, they hold a large quantity of U.S. treasuries, and the U.S. treasuries, they're losing money on that as well as the bond market sells off and interest rates rise. But finally, all of this goes back to what happened on February 26th, 2022. That is the most important day of 2022 so far. And that is when energy got canceled. And that is when the U.S. froze reserves of Russia, $630 billion worth of reserves. The dollar ceased to exist as basically the world we know it. Like, it's no longer the dollar that it was before because it's no longer fungible. As Arthur Hayes says, you cannot remove the world's largest energy producer and the collateral these commodity resources represent from the financial system without serious, unimagined, and unintended consequences. He wrote that before the unintended consequences started getting very rapid and very extreme. Things are about to get real because commodities, energy, all those things that underlie the value of our money, time, value, energy, time, energy, all that stuff, if your money can't tell you what that is, then the system disintegrates, right?
Right. When those assets were seized, essentially, it was the end of the financialized period of economics in the globe for decades and the beginning of a new era. And that era is going to be driven by price discovery by commodity producers. And, you know, you might not like the politics of the commodity producers, but you're going to buy gasoline at whatever price is at the pump. You don't have a choice. It's inelastic pricing. And even the UK this week said, you know, we're going to walk away from our ESG goals, our environmental goals in the energy markets, and we're going to start buying gas.
Right. But the most important thing, Max, the single most important thing from this to consider is that Arthur Hayes says rational countries with a capital account surplus must now save in another currency. That means gold, that means Bitcoin, because they cannot save their trillions of dollars of surplus in a currency that could be seized and reserves that could be seized. Any rational actor will, over the next few months and years, we're going to see the consequences of that, the seizure of reserves, of US dollar reserves on February 26, 2022. And that's why Max and Stacey Report are here.
The return of rationality. Well, we're gonna take a break. And when we come back, much more coming your way.
I'm Max Patrick, and this, of course, is Plucky. I got a new job. I'm now Plucky's trainer. We're doing some of these sit-ups here. He wants to get as strong as possible for the fiat money apocalypse.
That's right, Max. prevent heading into the fiat money apocalypse, and I'm stacking sats over Swan Bitcoin.
Oh, that's so smart, Plucky. How did you get so smart?
Get the Swan app.
Are you interested in Bitcoin but don't know where to start? Fold is the easiest and most fun way to earn Bitcoin on everything you do. The Daily Wheel is free for everyone. You just open the app and spin for free Bitcoin. Seriously, there's no catch. And get the free Fold card to earn Bitcoin back on every purchase. Download the Fold app and get started today.
Welcome back to Max and Stacey Report. I'm Max Kaiser. Time now to turn to Jeff Booth. He's the author of The Price of Tomorrow, Why Deflation is Key to an Abundant Future. And he's coming to us from an airport lounge, so you may hear some sounds in the background. Jeff, hi.
Thanks for having me, Max, Stacey.
All righty, Jeff, the global macro situation today is a lot different to anything almost anyone under 50 has ever seen. What exactly is happening on the macro level right now, and what do ordinary people need to understand in terms of what has changed and what this means for the economy and markets?
Just that question, hey. And that's the thesis of my book, is technology is moving faster and faster, wanting to drive prices down and give people more for less. And the only thing stopping that function, which is a free market function of us choosing things that give us more value, is a monetary policy that has to make prices go up because it's already insolvent. So it has to pretend it's solvent by destroying money and creating inflation. And those inflation targets, which are a feature of the system. If they reduce and it tips to deflation, the entire credit-based model of the world collapses and everything fails. So today, through that lens, you could see these almost the jaws of death opening up. One, the free market, or the what the market should look like, deflationary, where we get more all the time, prices continue to fall forever. And the world we live in, where prices are pushed higher unnaturally to be able to pay back debt that can't be repaid by a functioning market. So we have distorted money supply around the world, and that distorted money supply has a whole bunch of consequences around the world, but it's in breaking down in real time.
Right, so there's a natural drift of prices to go lower, or deflation, because humans are innovative and they figure out ways to do things more efficiently and how to communicate more efficiently, and prices kind of on their own would drift lower. Deflation is kind of a normal thing. And then you have anti-economics, which are the governments typically, are trying to introduce something to combat the natural deflationary tendencies by printing tons and tons of money, essentially to fund themselves. I mean, doesn't this kind of set up, and are we seeing dramatically now, this confrontation between, for lack of a better word here, the state and or the government versus those that are being governed?
Yeah, absolutely, and it's way bigger in your fairy tale narrative where you believe you live in a free market and you're fighting for freedom. And you don't have a vote in how much your money is destroyed. That's outside of your control. Then you don't really live in a democracy, because most of the government revenue comes from effectively a theft that transfers power, transfers wealth to a minority over a majority, transfers money from the middle class and poor to the wealthy and in power. And when you have that, communism and capitalism look virtually the same. And so left and right, all of the nonsense that you hear across the political spectrum is on top of this system. And you can imagine there's no politician that will stand up and say, I'm going to allow the free market to work and deflation to work. I'm going to tell you exactly where your money goes. Because if they did, the entire world would collapse, because we live in a credit-based system. So we actually don't want to believe a politician who would tell us the truth. So we vote for people who tell us lies, and that lie has to grow over and over through time. And so that's where we are in the cycle right now. And we're living in a big lie that the entire world's economic policy comes down to when 12 people are going to press a print button. And if they don't, if they actually continue to tighten, which they ultimately they can't, because everything breaks and you have a credit spiral, and when we're credit collapse spiral, and that credit collapse spiral would take down everything that people believe in today. Every bank would fail globally. You would, and so you can imagine, would people vote for that? They wouldn't vote for that. And that's why central banks become essentially control functions of the state over time, because the population demands that the government does something. And the thing the government's doing by manipulating money is hurting population the worst. So that's unfortunately where we are from the existing system. And from that, it's bound to get a lot worse.
Right. So we know that this tension between money printers and the productive economy has been going on for quite some time, and it's played out in different realms in the economy. On Wall Street in 2008, they reached a crisis point, a credit collapse, and Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers were forced to walk the plank. They were essentially sacrificed so that Jamie Dimon could live another day. I mean, that's yeah. What happened.
Exactly.
Okay. So, but on the geopolitical front, is this going to play out geopolitically where countries like Russia, China, Iran, and India that are now trading decide that the U.S., the United States, like Lehman Brothers, must walk the plank, Jeff?
So interesting in that, and with the U.S. being 90% of global trade and no other currency being able to step into the void of that global trade, it's not going to happen as fast as we think to that, because there essentially wouldn't be global trade. If effectively what every country is doing right now is almost every man for themselves. For the yen to protect their yield curve control, the only way they can protect their yield curve control, because it's going to cost them a fortune to do so, instead of hyperinflating through the yen, only way they can do that is sell U.S. treasuries. So as they sell U.S. treasuries, there's no bid for U.S. treasuries, and the U.S. is going to fund that deficit. So this entire thing is connected globally. You've probably talked a lot about kind of energy being priced in U.S. dollars, and then essentially what that means around the world is U.S. can print energy and everybody else has to pay for energy. What Russia just did is said, checkmate, your paper money isn't worth as much as my energy. And that's and these connections all around the world, as of things breaking, tend to break faster and faster around the world. And people are kind of look at the event that's breaking it as they, oh, that's what caused this whole break. When the break was easy to see from a long time ago, including in my book, and because when you predict this out from first principles, you realize what will happen. And so geopolitically, Max, and you know this, we move into a really scary world because you have to use coercion to drive your agenda. And that coercion turns into war and greater, and you manipulate your people to go to war against other people, all fighting for control of a currency, which is based on a lie.
You're right about the price of tomorrow, but let's talk about the price of yesterday. Because in El Salvador, the price of failed economic policies of yesterday was mass migration. The population dreamed of escaping to the U.S. Today, however, we have Bitcoin, Bukele, and a shift in consciousness to one in which El Salvador is the place we want to be. Your thoughts on this transformation in economic consciousness and what role Bitcoin and Bukele played?
He's going to go down as one of the smartest leaders of all time on this, because he was first into a new paradigm, and people are measuring that paradigm from the old paradigm, And so what Bukele is doing, just like any technology would do, it advantages the people most left out. And if you look at the US system of control, what they have to do to protect their currency is sacrifice externalities. And the externalities would be Africa, South America. And what Bukele did by moving first to a new system that is independent of that system and driving on a network effect has now moved the free market to Bukele. And you know, I was there and it's early. But there's a whole bunch of others around the world that are now looking at implementing the same policy. And we're the best, and based on freedom, talent, and capital, people move to the areas where, and they build great businesses of the future where they have that type of mobility. So I think Bukele's done a fantastic job in creating that model. And I think it's going to be replicated around the world, but by doing that first, a bunch of the talent has moved to El Salvador to be able to take advantage of where the world's moving to.
Right, and part of that financial revolution here will be the new volcano bonds that'll be issued. How does this change money as we know it?
So I don't specifically think that where the volcano bonds change the future of money. What I think is there's a whole bunch of innovations on ways to be able to finance government that is different than the world looked before. And one of those is volcano bonds. I think what changes the future is based on a stable foundation, prices are going to drop. And they're going to keep dropping, and people will move to the best areas around that, and the companies that, or the countries that have the most access to talent and capital will win the future, and that's what El Salvador is doing through their innovation there.
Right. Were you surprised to see this happening in Africa recently?
So I was more surprised to see it happen in El Salvador when it did. I said it wasn't on my bingo card for last year that you'd have nation state adoption, but now that there's nation state adoption, what's coming, I think will surprise people because it'll accelerate. It makes total sense that Africa would go next, or a nation in Africa, and more nations will. I'm flying to Madeira right now to have the same conversation with the president of Madeira. This makes perfect sense. And as more countries realize, okay, the existing system is based on manipulation, I'm going to build a future based not on manipulation.
All right, Jeff Booth, thanks for being on Max and Stacey Report.
Thanks so much.
All right, and that is going to do it for this edition of the Max and Stacey Report, coming to you from El Salvador, land of the free, home of the Bitcoin. Until next time, bye, y'all.